It is a little after 7:00. We've got some paperwork to clean up before we jump into the one permit that's open for tonight. The first part of the evening is for public comment. So if there's anybody here that has anything to say that doesn't have anything to do with the hearing tonight, raise your hand and we can hear what's on your mind. No? Okay. So, no public comment tonight. The first official duty tonight is we had an applicant from the last meeting that they withdrew the request. There's a continuation on a request from Catherine and John Chivaroli for a 30-foot wide curb cut and only 15 feet, which is allowed at 66 Bancroft Road, North Hampton, map ID 31B-3. The applicant withdrew their request before the last meeting. We didn't have a quorum, so it was pushed to tonight. So all I need is a motion to accept their request to withdraw their application.
And I would recommend that you do it with prejudice so they wouldn't come back within 2 years.
Right. And they've already started, they've already contacted DPW and they're already making progress in reducing what they have right now is a 30-foot drive. They're reducing it back to 15 feet, which is allowed. So looking for a motion to.
Accept withdrawal of prejudice?
Second.
Second, John. All in favor? Any discussion? Approved. And now we get to our old friend, Soccer at the Oxbow. So our next and only hearing for tonight is for a special permit at the Oxbow Marina for outdoor recreation soccer on Island Road, North Hampton, map IDs 45-58, 46-20, 21, 53-1, 2, and 4, as published on June 26th and July 3rd. So open up the hearing with a presentation.
I'm not sure where you want me to present from in this room. My name is Mark Tanner. I'm an attorney here in North Hampton. But I'm here tonight in my capacity as the de facto president of the North Hampton Soccer Club, sort of whether I like it or not in some instances. North Hampton Soccer Club is a nonprofit organization. We have a 501(c)(3) status, meaning any money that anybody gives us is tax deductible. And what we do is we run a youth travel soccer league for kids who live in North Hampton and the surrounding communities. As part of our bylaws, we have a provision that says if you're forming a team, at least half of the kids have to be from North Hampton. And the reality is about 90% of the kids who play on our teams are either from North Hampton or go to school in North Hampton. For those of you who've been around this issue for a long time, there used to be a program called Western United, which is it's a level of soccer above what our kids play, which also had fields at the Oxbow. And they had, my understanding, between 10 and 15 teams who regularly practiced and played at the Oxbow. That's not the case with our club. We have kids in our program starting at about 7, going through in the spring season anyway, under 16s. The under 16s don't play the ball because they're playing high school soccer. So by and large, the kids who are involved in our program are between 7 and under 14. So grade schoolers up to 8th graders. The people who actually utilize the fields at the Oxbow are the under 11s through the under 14s, both boys and girls. The younger kids either practice at Jackson Street for the really little kids, or they practice and play at the Leeds school field, which the city makes available to us. And so although we have a modified field at the Oxbow, the reality is it gets used for the older kids' practices so that you can play small-sided games on a smaller field instead of trying to play a full-sided game with not enough kids to do that. If you're familiar with the Oxbow, when you pull in and you're facing the marina, there are really two sections of the grass area that we use there. There's the area to the right, which is by where the tennis courts are, which is actually the nicer area. There's the area to the left, which is the huge expanse of grass, and that's where the fields are located right now. What we've historically done is tried to rotate back and forth between those two areas so that the grass doesn't all get killed in any particular season. The area to the right, which is closer to the river and closer to the tennis courts, is actually a much flatter area. The grass is much nicer. But out of deference to Mr. Duda, we try not to use that area much because that's where his boat people from the people who are actually using the marina park their cars. A lot of the people go down there and hang out on their boats, and they don't necessarily want to look at kids playing soccer while they're on their boats. So we try and keep the fields to the other side, but occasionally in the fall, when the level of the water in the river isn't an issue, we'll put a field down on the other end, just let the grass rest up in the big area. Right now, we have two full-size fields and one modified field at the Oxbow, and that's about what it's always been down there. We really don't have a need for more fields than that. The reality is the most games they ever schedule at any one time down there is one. So just to digress a bit, we're part of a larger organization called the Pioneer Valley Junior Soccer League, which is teams from throughout basically the Pioneer Valley, as far away as Ware, Agawam, those towns. Kids play at different levels within PBJSL. There's the first division, which is supposed to be the highest quality soccer, clear down to the third division, which is basically recreational soccer. So there's a place on our teams, and we try and make a place on our team for whoever wants to play. So it's not like we're some sort of super exclusive club. There are teams which are competitive teams, but at the same time, we also field a number of teams which are just kids who want to play soccer. And so we're really the vehicle for kids who want to play soccer in the greater Northampton area. Once they get out of like the Wook Park sort of soccer that they run through the recreation department. There's been ongoing soccer at the Oxbow for a long time. And as long as I've been involved in the club, the initial issue with regard to the people who lived on Island Pond Road was the traffic, and there's always been concerns about the traffic. I think a lot of that traffic issue was driven by Western United, and at the point that they left, which was in 2010-2011-ish, we came back before the board, and there were some hearings on the permit, and some additional conditions were imposed by the board with regard to, well, let's really see what happens once Western United leaves, and let's see what the traffic is really like down there, and let's kind of play this by ear as it goes. The original one of those conditions was right at the end of Island Pond Road. There's some land that's owned by, I think, Packaging Corporation of America, which sort of became a parking lot, even though we never really had permission to park cars there. And the permit, one of the permits anyway, said that we needed to park there and then carpool down. In working through things with Mr. Hasbrook, who I've been in contact with pretty regularly since I got involved in the club, what we did was basically reach an agreement that as long as we were carpooling from some location, that he would consider it carpooling under the permit. The reality is, and we were talking with Mr. Douglas before I came up here, the reality is parents don't want to drive to the Oxbow. It's not an easy place to get to. And so by default, if there are groups of kids in a neighborhood, they carpool to practice. And we encourage that, and we tell people that they need to do that when they sign up for the club, and we send out emails reminding people that they need to carpool. And so we're complying with the spirit, and Mr. Hasbrook, my understanding, has been happy with it, by carpooling from home as opposed to parking in that location and carpooling from the PCA parking lot. The one exception to that we really don't have a whole lot of control over is when kids come from other towns to play. By and large, those people are going to come as a family. They're going to have one kid in their car. And so although our players may be carpooling to games, our players may be carpooling to practices, when people come from these towns that we're playing, it's pretty hard to enforce a carpooling ban against them. Although at the start of the year, PBJSL does send out an email to all those towns with certain particularities about different towns. And one of the things that they send out is no dogs in Wilbraham, and you have to carpool to the Oxbow. Those are always conditions that get sent out to the various people from other towns. But once again, it's hard for us as a volunteer organization to really say you have to carpool, you can't come play here. We've given you traffic counts pursuant to the permit. I believe Carolyn has them for the last couple of years. If you look at them, the numbers are, at least in my mind, not enormous numbers. What you'll see is when PBJSL schedules soccer games on weeknights at the Oxbow, and the only teams that play on weeknights at the Oxbow are Division I teams. Division II teams and the Division III teams only play on Saturday and Sunday. So the reality is, there's probably a game at the Oxbow one night a week. And the reason I say that is because when PBJSL schedules games during the week, they try and schedule two games in a row so that they can attract referees to come to the games. The referees don't want to show up and referee one game. It's not worth their time, they don't make enough money. So generally speaking, NSC has three or four Division I teams at the most of all the teams that we have. And so if you figure that two of them are playing home that week and the other ones are playing away that week, almost by default it works out that there's only one weeknight game. If you look at the traffic counts that we gave you, and I have our most recent season schedule to share with you, what you'll see is that the traffic is really centered around when the games occur. And what you'll see is, you know, a half an hour or an hour before a game, there's a surge in the traffic. The two games happen, there's a surge in the traffic as people leave. And the rest of the time, there's not really a whole lot of traffic on the roads. The teams that practice at the Oxbow, once again, are the under-11s through the under-14s. And you're really talking about, so most teams would practice one or two nights a week. The Division I teams usually practice one night a week because they're also playing a game during the week, and it's just impossible to fit in another practice. So you figure between those that four-year age span, the most teams I think that we've ever had is eight. Four boys, four girls team, or some mixture of teams. So it's not like there are 30 teams that are using that area as practice space either. If you look at the schedule that I gave you, what you'll see is that for the spring season, I want to say that there were 35 games from April until June that were played at the Oxbow. So it's not like the field is being used for games every night continuously and there's a continuous flow of traffic. I understand that if you live on a small, narrow street, any traffic is a lot of traffic. But what we've done is really try to address those issues through carpooling, by providing these traffic counts, by doing those sorts of things. I've been in contact with Louie pretty regularly since I became the president of the club. And during the time that I've been involved on a board level capacity, to my knowledge, he's received one complaint. And I have, and that was in September of 2012. I have a copy of the email. Louie sent me the email he received. I then responded to everyone on the list, introducing myself, saying, "I'm Mark Pan, I'm the head of the club. If you have any issues at all, please contact me." I can also tell you that my contact information is all over the web. All you have to do is Google Northampton Soccer. And for better or for worse, I'm going to be the guy who you end up finding and emailing. And once again, I've been in pretty regular contact with the building inspector. And if there was an issue, I'm sure that he would call me and let me know that there's an issue. I deal with him on other issues professionally pretty regularly. And by and large, the talk comes back to soccer because we'd rather talk about that than work. And once again, he hasn't said, you know, people are concerned, people are doing this, people are doing that. The deal we have with Mr. Duda is essentially this. He gives us the use of the fields of all that area. What we pay is for him to hire someone to mow the grass and line the fields. And so we pay to use the Oxbow about $9,000 a year between those things, which is pretty expensive. You figure all the revenue we take in a year is about $35,000. And so as a portion of our budget, using the Oxbow fields is a pretty big portion of the budget. But it's also pretty important to us. And the reason is that even with the new Florence fields, whenever they come online, there's still not enough sports fields in Northampton, unfortunately. The two programs that don't really get the use of the local, of the rec department's fields, are our club and the lacrosse club. And that's just because the fields are bigger and, quite frankly, there's just not enough space. They've been very generous with us, always giving us the use of the Leeds field. But as far as the bigger fields are concerned, During soccer season, they're occupied by the high school teams or by the rec department's older teams. And so they just aren't available on a regular basis. And they have a whole priority system as to who has access to those fields. I can tell you that I speak with Mr. Duda pretty regularly as well about how we're using the fields and what we're doing. And it really, as a practical matter, he's making a huge monetary donation to us every year to let us use the fields, because he could very easily rent that same area to a farmer for a lot more than the $9,000 or so that we pay him every year. I can tell you that he's also made that area available, for example, to the Ultimate Frisbee team from the Northampton High School. They approached me and said, "You've got this huge grass area, can we use it?" I said, "It's not mine to let you use. You need to talk to Mr. Duda. You need to talk to Louis. You need to make sure that it's okay to do it." And they went and they spoke with the city, and he donated the use of that area for them as well. And so it's not a situation where he's making money hand over fist by letting us use this area, because he's certainly not. What we're asking for you to do as a board is to allow us to continue using that area. Historically, there's been a temporal limitation on how long our permits last. As a practical matter, what that does is prevents us from really investing any money and making the fields nice. Mr. Duda has riparian rights on the river, or he has water rights on the river, and those fields in the past have been irrigated. Not knowing whether we're going to have the use of those fields from year to year makes that cost prohibitive for us to invest the money to actually fertilize the fields and to water the fields and to do those sorts of things. And so by the end of the season, you're really talking about dirt and weeds is what we're planning on, by and large. What we're asking is for you not to put a temporal limitation in the permit, to instead, because I understand that maybe seeing traffic is a concern of people, to put conditions in which reasonably require us to affirmatively address the traffic issue on an ongoing basis, through carpooling, through some mechanisms. And that would be a vehicle to bring us back before the board, or to bring us before the building inspector in the event that something went wrong. It also gives us some incentive to make sure that things don't go wrong. The other thing that I'm going to ask you to do is, there's always, or at least for the past several years, been the condition with regard to providing a traffic study or a traffic count. That costs us about $1,000. Which is a 35th of our budget. We try and keep our fees as low as possible. And that's a pretty big chunk of money every year that we pay to them for a traffic study, which is essentially showing the same thing over time. I think we could replace providing that traffic study with providing game schedules, which we now have the ability to print out pretty quickly. And it would show you the number of games that were scheduled on those fields for the entire year. I can show the staff how many teams we have enrolled that would be practicing or playing down there. And I think it's pretty easy to extrapolate the traffic pattern and the traffic flow that's going to come from those things. As I said before, the most teams we've ever had in those age divisions is about 8. The reality is Northampton as a city is not growing in population. I think we're pretty stagnant. And it's, as long as I've been around the club, we've always had about the same number of kids, which is about 180 in total, spread out over the various teams. So I'd ask you to do two things. I'd ask you to grant the permit, take away the temporal limitation so that we can afford to spend some time and money making these fields nicer than they currently are, and to take out the requirement for the traffic count and replace that with giving us an obligation to provide you with a game schedule and provide you with the number of teams that are going to be using that field. To the staff on an annual basis. If you have questions, I'm happy to answer your questions.
Questions by the board? Do you know from the traffic studies when Western, what was the other soccer group?
Was that Western United?
Western United. When they left, what the delta was between when the two clubs were playing together and then when they left?
I don't. I tried to go back and look at some of the historical records on your site today. That was before I got involved. But I know that the number of teams that were using that area was at least doubled. And those kids were all coming from throughout the Pioneer Valley. So I have to imagine that there were the number
trips back and forth was substantially more.
That was 2010?
I want to say it was 2009, 2010.
I think the original permit may have been, yeah, even earlier.
Yeah, there was a permit from 2007 that was given to Jonathan Wright. But I know as long as...
Then it came back up.
Yeah, then it came in 2010.
I know when my older daughter was playing West United as a under 11, she went to East Long Meadow to practice. And so she's 14 now, so that was, what, 3 years ago.
2010, according to this. Oxbow Soccer Fields dispute might be over from the Gazette. August 16th, 2010 is when they left.
So what would you do different in terms of the parking? I mean, you sort of in the presentation said that you can't really do anything to enforce.
Well, and so when Tony Patella was the building inspector, he essentially came to that conclusion too, when he gave the board or staff basically a memo saying this condition is unenforceable. What we've done as a club is tell people to carpool from home. I know that there was a period of time for at least a couple of years when we would go down there and spot check to see if people were doing that. And my understanding is his report back was that we were in fact complying with that. Once again, just because by default people don't want to drive to the Oxbow. I live in the middle of Florence, and on a weeknight it's a half an hour for me to get down there. And so I take the five kids who live within a mile radius of me when I go to practice, just because no one wants to drive a half an hour to be at practice for an hour and a half to drive another half an hour home. So we would certainly accept that as a condition that there be carpool.
If I understand the schedule right, it looks like it's like two-thirds games on Saturday, Sunday, one-third during the week.
So generally speaking, there would be two games on a Saturday, two games on a Sunday, maybe three games. And then the most they would have in the spring season would be two games. A lot of times in the fall season, they'll only have one game on a weeknight just because it gets dark earlier. In that case, you just pay the referee time and a half is what happens.
So but this is a game schedule, but there's practices every night.
There are. So you not necessarily every night. You figure the Division I teams, because most of those kids also play on another team, usually practice one night a week and have games one night a week, and then have their other teams' practices, which are the Western United kind of teams, two nights a week. The kids who play on the other teams, the Division II teams and the Division III teams, some of those teams practice at the Oxbow. A lot of those teams practice on open space wherever they can find it because it's easier to get to. For example, our under 13s team practiced in Williamsburg because there's a field behind the school that's always open and it's much easier to get to.
Anybody else?
Just a question about the carpooling. The sense I'm getting is that the issue is not necessarily about the total trip from house to field, but about, you know, what happens when someone gets right down to the Oxbow, and that's more about shuttling kids from a particular spot right to the field versus carpooling from home. So is it feasible to, you know, be shuttling as opposed to carpool for the full trip duration?
I mean, so what generally happens is a lot of the parents who drive their kids to practice stay there until they're done practicing. And so we actually tried to do that for a while on my team just to see how it worked. And it's a great idea in theory.
Yeah.
As a practical matter, it's very hard to do.
Because of space or because there isn't a vehicle that can go back and forth?
What would happen is they would bring their kids there, they would get in another car, they'd drive down, and the parents would still be there, but they'd want to be there watching practice. And so they'd have to figure out a way to get down to the fields anyway.
Right.
And it was hard to enforce because there was that side parking area, and the premise was everybody meet there, get jam as many kids as you can in one car, and make one trip down, mom or dad stays, and then they come back.
Right.
But it wasn't happening, it was hard to enforce. Then they were saying, okay, drop the kids off and have them walk. Didn't like that because they're 10-year-old kids and you don't want them walking down by the river. So, and then it was just, so people were taking pictures, people were counting, you know, cars, and it just got real messy. It was hard to enforce.
Yeah.
I mean, the premise was good, but it was just, in practicality, it was hard to do.
But it's not the property, the shuttle pickup area is not owned by Duda or, you know, right, so that's
And I can tell you, I actually put up a number of signs down there saying park, and they got torn down every time I put up a sign.
And this may not have to do exactly with this, but you, I think you made a comment. What relation, if any, do the new fields coming in Florence have to this issue?
I'd love to say that we'll have access to them all the time. I honestly don't think that would be the case. And the reason I say that is we take the Ellerbrook Field as an example. It's the nicest field in town, and no one ever gets to use it. And once again, in the hierarchy of things, the rec teams get priority, all the high school teams and the school teams, and then the rec teams, and then everybody else. And so, for example, lacrosse rents out space at Le Park right now, is how they play their games.
I have one question, about, you've made a comment about not using a certain part of the field because the people who have boats there are down on their boats. What period of time is there overlap between boating and soccer? Is it just in the spring, so the late spring?
It's the late spring and the early fall. And so what I was trying to do is reassure the board that we're not going to have 15 soccer fields down there. If you limited us to two large fields and two small fields, which are really practice fields, that would be more fields than we would ever need.
I apologize for being late, and maybe this was mentioned, but how many years has have these fields been used for soccer? Is it 2010?
I don't know, but no, it's much, much longer than that. I mean, so before I got involved with the board, there was a guy named Tim Stokes, who was the president of the club, and it was his position that they were grandfathered under the zoning because they'd been used so long. I don't think that's a fight that's worth having with anybody. I think we should affirmatively address the traffic issues. But I think they've been used, that area's been used as soccer fields for an excess of 20 years.
Can I answer that question?
No. Any other questions by the board?
All right, thank you.
Okay, so we're going to open this up to public comment. So if you can raise your hand, I'll call on you, and just give me your name and address, and then we'll take all the comments by the public. We'll keep the public hearing open. We'll have an open discussion with the board. It's a question and answer thing. And then at some point, when there aren't any more questions, we're going to close public comment. And at that point, it's an internal discussion with the board. So if you have anything to say, now's the time to say it. And when you want to say it, if you speak once and then you think of something later that you want to say and you can get a chance, just raise your hand again. But this is always a very engaged discussion. So we're looking forward to it. So let's just jump in, just raise your hand and we'll see. Yes.
Hello, my name is Jennifer Remillard. I live at 178 Island Road. I've been a resident of the Island Ferry Ave area for August 1st, it'll be 11 years. My husband and I bought a home on Island Road in 2006. I have a couple comments as well as responses to Mr. Tanner's comments or presentation. So, when we moved in 2003, we weren't aware of as much traffic as occurred later on when we became residents of Island Road from Ferry. When you're on Ferry, you can't notice it as much. However, while being there, when we first moved in 2003, the soccer fields were only utilized by Northampton teams on the right hand when you drive down Island Road. Are all of you familiar with the setup on the right? And there were just a minimal number of fields. After a certain period of time, I believe in 2006, 2007, I apologize if my dates aren't accurate, Mr. Duda purchased the farm field, which was on the left-hand side, which were the larger fields, and that increased the amount of traffic on our street due to the increased amount of soccer fields which became available. I believe at one point there were 8 fields on the left-hand side, which, yes, has dropped down to a minimal amount. We have been very appreciative of the reduction in numbers since Western United left. That was, you know, very noticeable. However, the current traffic conditions still continue to be a nuisance for the residents who live there year-round. We pay our taxes, and we have a right to enjoy our homes as well as our property. In 2007, Jonathan Wright was able to obtain from Florence Savings Bank a donation of a speech monitor, which is approximately diagonal from our property, so we were able to see it. Within a year, year and a half of that, the speed monitor was removed, although the pole and the solar monitor still exists. I apologize, I don't have a picture tangible, but I can email after the hearing or let you see it on my cell phone if you would like. So there are no traffic calming measures taken by the team other than the one sign that is located at the entrance and exit at the marina, which asks people to go 20 miles an hour. Previously, with Jonathan Wright, there were traffic calming measures. We have lived here for 11 years, and this is our third person that we are dealing with the soccer clubs. And there is, you know, they don't have to live there year-round. They don't deal with this issue on a continual basis. When we have issues, we try not to be confrontational, so we go to Carolyn Mish or to Lewis Hasberg, who's the building commissioner. Contrary to Mr. Tanner's comment, I actually sent an email in September of 2013 inquiring for the traffic counts as well as addressing the issue about the carpooling not being utilized. I can give this to you if you'd like to look at it or not. But no response was given regarding the carpooling issue. We were given the traffic counts by Carolyn, but I assume it's not her position to respond to that. It's Mr. Hasbrook's. As well as that, the traffic counts, according to the permit, which I have the copies of all the permits that have been issued, they are supposed to provide traffic counts twice a year. Spring and fall, and that has not occurred but maybe once or twice during the time. Every year it has been the spring. And if you are familiar with living on Island Road, you are well aware of the flood conditions that occur, and this year the traffic count was done during our flood week, where the left fields were actually pretty much drenched and were very unusable by anyone. We've had that continually occur in the spring. So the fact that they provide only spring counts could actually be not 100% reliable, and I don't expect them to be 100% accurate regardless, because at the top of the street, as you may be familiar, there's a telephone pole with a little kind of indent off the side of the road where people can drive down there, you know, and avoid the traffic counter and go down. They could turn around on ferry before dropping their child off at the marina if someone so chose. I don't know or have any personal knowledge of that occurring, but it's an option for avoiding the traffic counter altogether. In addition, in 2009, to address the comment by Mr. Patillo, who was the building commissioner at the time, saying that that was unenforceable, I took it to the Zoning Board of Appeals, and I was given a unanimous vote for their decision, and it says, quote, the Zoning Board of Appeals found that the building commissioner was correct to deny, the Zoning Board voted unanimously to overturn the building commissioner's decision because the commissioner misinterpreted the nature of the relief requested, which was merely to enforce the use of the auxiliary parking lot as required by the special permit issued by the Planning Board. The Zoning Board of Appeals found that the building commissioner was correct to deny a cease and desist action with respect to continued use of the soccer fields, but that enforcement of the requirement to use the auxiliary parking lot as requested by the appellant and as required by the special permit was appropriate. And that is dated, I'm just trying to find the date. Know that it was in favor here. That's the submission. Voting decision deadline was September 5th, 2009. It's on your system if you so chose to look at that. Going forward from the 2007 permit, we were given the conditions included using the off-site parking area, which was to accommodate up to 60 cars. The Northampton Soccer Club and Western United at the time got permission from the parking, from the Packaging Corporation Association, PCA, which is the company on the corner, and they have allowed usage of that lot for that purpose. It is used very minimally, and the times that we have addressed that with Mr. Hasbrook, in 2011, he sent a letter to Mr. Tanner saying the condition concerning traffic reduction states, you know, the information, the applicant shall utilize an off-site parking area to enable park and walking to fields and or carpooling fields. Such a site shall accommodate 60 cars. The board's determination included the wording, the applicant will utilize a parking lot off-site for at least 60 vehicles to reduce the total number of vehicles traveling down Island Road to Marina slash soccer site. And then Mr. Hasbrook says, if the club chooses to utilize a parking area other than the PCA lot at the west end of Island Road, I will require some sort of proof that a significant number of the players are carpooling. Please contact me to discuss how we might verify this. During Mr. Tanner's presentation, he indicated that that was something that had been going on. The residents are unaware of any such proof or whatnot, so you know, I cannot speak to knowledge of that. I can speak to, however, taking my dogs on walks in the evening and having to stop below whatever property I'm on to walk down the road to take them out. Several occasions over the years, I have almost been run over weeding my front lawn, getting my mail out of my mailbox because it happens to be in the end of my walkway in the front of the home. We have been emailing grievances to Ms. Mish and Mr. Hasbrook since this started in 2007 time frame. We have you know, not really received any relief from the issue. The fact that people say that carpooling is done outside or there's no control over out-of-town soccer teams that come into play at the arena versus the Northampton Soccer Club. If they purchased a used minivan or a used small vehicle with the $35,000 that they purchased, yes, I understand they're a nonprofit, so I'm not sure. I've never seen their finances, so I cannot speak to the amount available. If you spend $5,000 to utilize a van or something else, or $10,000 and maintain it over the course, that in the long run would benefit everyone, and we wouldn't be having this issue. My biggest concern at this point also is the the planning board permit that was issued to be valid for 3 months, effective for the spring 2011 season. This is dated, it's hard to read when the dates are, but decision deadline was July 13 of 2011. I understand they've been grandfathered in by the agricultural MGL that's been going on for the past few years that allowed that. But in there, on item two, it says condition two, the applicant may only schedule games at the fields and no practices. And during Mr. Tanner's presentation, he indicates that the Division I teams are utilizing it during the week for practices. I can speak to the fact that the teenage drivers do not pay any mind going up and down Island Road as to the traffic, the speed, or whatnot. Now, I understand teenagers are going to do what they must, but they should be mindful and aware of our road and the rules. And a lot of people do not obey the 20-25 mile an hour speed limit going down our road. The maximum number of games continuing condition allowed will be 30 or half of the previous season's games. And I have not seen a game schedule since 2011, which was emailed out by Mr. Hasbrook. I can say that yes, I have not asked to see them. I've gone online on occasion to view the website that's public. Submit a game to OPD and also make the schedule available to the neighborhood. It says in here on item two, the requested use will promote under findings. The requested use will promote the convenience and safety of vehicular and pedestrian movement within the site and on adjacent streets, minimize traffic impacts on the streets and roads in the area. The permanent speed board helps drivers monitor speeds, reduced game schedule minimizes total volume. We don't have a permanent speed monitor any longer, and that was not there in 2011 when this was submitted. That had been moved probably 2008, 2009. Now, while I understand, I'm a mother of a son who plays sports, who's played sports. I coached a soccer team when my son was younger. I have nothing against the use of fields for various usage. However, Mr. Duda did not seek a permit to expand on those fields on the left side to incorporate a larger traffic volume, a larger soccer usage way back in 2006, because initially, how we got to this point here in front of this board was the soccer club did not have permission to expand, and the neighbors and residents came to and complained, and they were told that they needed to get a permit to do that. So in turn, I appreciate your time. I know this is an ongoing issue that's been going on for a very long time and must be tiring after a while. However, since the implementation of this permit and the conditions, they have not been obeyed. They do not provide counts twice a year like they're required. They do not park at the parking lot. I can say that yes, on occasion that it has been used. I have seen it. I'm not saying it's never been used, but it's not used on a regular, consistent basis, which was the spirit of this permit and which was the spirit of the initial presentation in 2007 by Mr. Wright. I can honestly say that Mr. Wright did give a great effort. Mr. Stokes did not give such a great effort. Mr. Tanner, I have not dealt with on a regular basis because I've chosen to utilize the building inspector's office as well as Carolyn Mesh for email contact and complaints and whatnot. Mr. Tanner hasn't been here since the beginning, so, you know, it's been frustrating for us the whole entire journey. And I ask that you deny this application. I ask that if you do allow this application, that you have strict conditions that are enforceable, that are able to have some kind of a relief. And also, maybe they could use, if they were to be allowed, which I understand, you know, that soccer has been going on there for a very long time. However, the expansion was not permitted, and that's why the permit was done to begin with. Because if they do get approved, maybe they can get a small portion of donation for traffic calming measures that are permanent on our road. If you have been down Island Road, our road is in great dire repair or disrepair because of the volume already going to the marina year-round for ice fishing, for regular, you know, leisure during boats, etc. Adding this additional usage creates a nuisance for the neighbors, the traffic, and it is cumbersome for a street that you cannot fit two cars down going both ways majority of the time, different spots in the area you can. But I really ask that you don't allow this because they have not met the conditions. And if you don't give an end date, if you were to approve it, who's to say that, you know, issues aren't going to occur? They're not going to be subjected to certain things that, you know, certain people feel are unenforceable, whereas the ZBA felt were enforceable. So it creates a conflict amongst the city staff. You know, how can you do your job appropriately if there's no way to enforce it? So I thank you for your time.
I'm Juliet Simon, and I live on 91 Island Road, otherwise known as the horrible little open arm hippie house. But I just want to say a couple things quickly, and then Kevin has more professional, official stuff. But I want to reiterate, first of all, everything that she said just down. Also, it is not about us not wanting kids to play soccer. I can't stand that thought that people would think that because I have kids too. But the thing is, kids playing soccer, that should not trump kids being safe on the street they live on. I'm sorry, but like my friends literally left the street because they had a baby a year and a half ago. And other people with small children, they can't even ride a bike, you know, when traffic is bad. There's no sidewalks. Basically, the street is like dying already of traffic. And one thing that I regret is none of us have a video. We had a group snafu information thing, and some of us didn't find out about the meeting, but I wanted to make a video of, this is not an exaggeration, almost every car is one kid in it. I have not seen, almost, I mean, that rarely I will see a carpool go by, but I see so, I sit, my porch is like 10 feet from the road, and I sit out there. Sometimes it's like cars are going by like, literally like that, I wish we could just get rid of the marina, you know? I would rather, like, but with both of them, it's just, I've lost three kittens over the course of time, my mom's owned the house I live in since 1978, and it's always been, you know, the marina traffic was bad enough, but I just, you know, I wish that you could just come and see, or, you know, just experiencing it, literally seeing, and they are not obeying the speed limit at all. Some of them do, but many of them literally fly by. It's terrifying. Most of the houses on the street are very close to the road. There is like, if a kid just got out somehow, you know, and 3 seconds, and it's, so it's, I feel like it's literally dangerous. As a matter of fact, when we were trying to work with the carpooling, for a while there was talk of having people walk. They said they didn't want to because the street was too dangerous. And to me, that just says it all. Like, if your kids can't walk on the street, I mean, and I don't want to be, you know, it's not personal, but it's just the, it's hard to live there and not start to feel resentful. And one other thing was that you mentioned, like, you know, complaining officially. Many of us have just stopped. Like, it's not that we don't still care. I'm just so over it. Never changes. It did get better when the other lead went away slightly, but not amazingly. And it's just, so I don't think, you know, I'm not going to say, I wish ideally, yeah, no more soccer. I don't see that happening, but at the very least, can we please not just have them, you know, with no limits? And if anything, we need more limits and more conditions. And we need, more importantly, them to do it. And I totally get that you can't control parents, like you can't make them do that. I do understand, but the shuttle idea, you know, you can take the parents too. They don't have to sit in the parking lot. They can get down to the field and watch the game. There should be a little, I'll even do it. Anyways, thank you. I think that's everything.
Thank you.
Next. I'm Catherine Zakowski, and I live at 99 Island Road. I've lived there about 11 years. And just a little bit of the history going back. Going back to that question about the soccer fields being grandfathered in. This is an article that says Louis Hasbrook agreed that the use of the field is considered an accessory to the marina's mission, and that they need a special permit because soccer and other sports were not specifically included in a variance in 1975 that allowed the operation and construction of the marina. So there were two small fields that were present down there, but it wasn't that big of a deal. So I don't know how long that went on, because I've only been there 11 years, but they were there when I got there. Yeah, the marina traffic is irritating, but that's what I moved into. It was okay, it was tenable, it was all right. Then when Mr. Duda acquired that land, he didn't get the permit, he turned it into a soccer complex. It was crazy. It was bumper to bumper to bumper to bumper. That's how we got in this position. The original spirit of when they applied for that permit years back, when it came to this, was, well, they're here, the fields are already here, so let's grant the permit temporarily while the city of Northampton acquires other land to make fields so that we can diminish the use of the Oxbow. That was the whole intention of granting a temporary permit. And so the town has done that, and people have fought hard to get land so that soccer fields can be used other places and not at the marina. So, you know, the question of like, well, what impact do the other fields have? And Mr. Tanner saying, well, I don't even know if we're gonna get to use them. It makes me crazy because we've been fighting this fight for so long. And I feel like, you know, the board turns over and the soccer presidents turn over and the soccer parents turn over, but the residents and poor Carolyn have been here from the get-go, like, you know, carrying the torch of like, you know, please, let's remember the original intentions. So I feel like we have to go way back and pretend those soccer fields don't exist. Now, are we gonna allow soccer fields there? If we backed way up to that, we should say yay or nay. And if it's yay, here's the specific things that need to be implemented for sure. Like no questions asked. I mean, there's just all this unenforceable stuff that's in these documents. And there's been a little bit of an effort there, but some of them aren't that hard to, you know, like submitting the accounts twice a year. I mean, like, they can do that, but they haven't. So I feel like this issue is like a runaway train and no one is putting the brakes on it because soccer is so popular. But the thing is there's never gonna be enough fields. Mr. Tanner already said that. It's like you build it, they will come. So I'm fearful that this is just gonna go on and on and on without stipulation. And it's really hard and it makes me wanna abandon the street like other people have. And it's a great place, but it's kind of untenable. So I do want to acknowledge that things have gotten better since Western United left. That's definitely for sure. I am grateful for the emails that go out there that say carpool. Occasionally I see more than one soccer kid in the car, but it's kind of a rarity. It's certainly not the majority. You know, Mr. Wright secured that parking lot it was his idea that he used that as the commuter lot. That wasn't our idea, that was his idea. So he got the information, he pulled that together, it got used a little bit, and then it didn't. You know, and you know, this was taken today, you know, it's in the dirt, and I feel like that kind of sums things up. It's like,
That's the sign?
That's the sign.
This is the sign, like...
I put that thing up like...
4 years ago. This is what it looked like. It had a nice... You know, this is what Jonathan Wright did. He had a chart, but not long after that, it was in the ground. You know, it got used sometimes. This is, like, one of the signs, sandwich boards that these used to be around, up by Northampton Soccer. There were things that got put in place, but as there's turnover, it doesn't stick. And so another thing I want to point out is five of my steps. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So from here to there, that's my living room. That is I did a survey. I got out with my measuring tape. That is the average distance from the road to people's living room. So it's not just the amount of traffic, it's the speed of the traffic. And it's not just the soccer traffic. You know, there's these yachts that go down Island Road. There's boat trailers. The road is falling apart. And you add soccer traffic and it's like, it's crazy. So I feel like it's a runaway train. And then recently we had 39 schools playing Ultimate Frisbee there. 39 high school teams. I didn't know anything about it. All of a sudden I couldn't cross my street. So, you know, it's like, where does it end? Are they gonna put in lights down there? Are they gonna make night games? Like, are they gonna put in McDonald's? Like, where does it end? I mean, it's sort of comical, but who's to say that they can't just, I don't know, allow lacrosse there tomorrow? Why not? Like, the field, you build it, they will come. I know people who, men's soccer, go down there They're not allowed down there, but they want to play, they need a field, they didn't sign up where they're supposed to, so they're like, let's go down to the Oxbow and play. Because they're there! It's like a free-for-all down there. So, let me just see if there's anything else in all of my notes. And the thing about the carpool is that I appreciate that the emails go out about it, but we're not that great as a society about carpooling, and a little email that goes out isn't gonna make that big of an impact on a mom that's running out the door and didn't plan ahead. Like, that's kind of human nature. And, you know, another problem that we saw in the years past is people would drop their kids off, go get coffee, and come back. So now you're adding more to it. And, well, that's, I think that's all I've got.
Thank you.
Oh, can you read that?
I don't know what that is. This is
the ultimate frisbee.
Yeah, just talking about the other opportunities. I received an email from a woman named Jennifer Bryan, because earlier this spring, it was in May, there were a ton of cars, over 200, I mean, literally over 200 cars parked on that side. And I went down and I was not too happy, but I was polite to the woman and I said, look, I said, do you guys have a permit? What are you here for, etc. And I thought it was soccer. It was Ultimate Frisbee. And I said, you know, she said, we received three email addresses, mind you, from Krista, Sally Atkinson, and Juliet Simon, and one was to Carolyn, CC'd by Mr. Hasbrook. Now, Mr. Hasbrook has been emailing with myself, Dave Tischler, Catherine, my husband, and other residents, and has our email addresses because I've corresponded with him over the past year regarding other issues. And those are the only three people he gave the email address to for these Ultimate Soccer people, or Frisbee, excuse me. So as of Monday, February 24th, 4:40 p.m., to Lee Felcher, who's the person that Mr. Tanner had, I would assume, approached about the, or he had approached them about the Frisbee, we approved use of the fields at Oxbow Marina for the Northampton High School Ultimate Frisbee Team Tournament. Since there are school teams, it is allowed by right as an educational use. We sent the approval back to you. I think you should reach out to the Island Road residents. I've copied them on this email. Perhaps you could send them some specific information on the event. Now, when speaking with Ms. Bryan, she did indicate that they tried, and she sent me the email traffic, which is what I was reading to you, and I'm more than happy to forward it to you if you would like. My concern is, one, when did Oxbow Marina fields become used for educational anything? That I haven't seen one iota of paperwork that says that, so I'm questioning.
I can jump in. I think we're getting away from, this isn't really soccer.
So anyways, if you allow the permit, who's to say, as Catherine said, that other events aren't going to continue to occur without.
Anybody else? Yeah.
My name is JT Rimmelard. I also live on Island Road. Been a resident for 11 years, as my wife said. I was gone to Europe in 2006, 2007, and she warned me what springtime was going to be like with the expanded soccer, and I didn't believe her until it happened. Literally, as they said, bumper to bumper traffic, couldn't pull out of the driveway, and since they have reduced it, it is much better. However, much better between having 300 cars an hour and 100 cars an hour is relative. The problem is there is not the carpooling that they claim. People speed. The road is 19 feet wide, which does not allow a lot of room for people speeding. My house is on a curve. You get to hear the brakes squealing, people yelling at each other because nobody wants to yield right away. When we did complain to the city, what we received was no parking signs. This is limited use only in the residential area. It was supposedly for safety. However, the ends of the street, you can still park on both sides. So therefore, the argument that it's needed to get a fire truck down the street doesn't hold when you're allowed to block the ends of the street. What we have asked the city for time and time again, traffic calming measures. If you go to a kid's high school game, junior high, police are required to be there. EMTs, other such things. Except for the ultimate frisbee, we never see a cop on the road. Nobody comes down to monitor traffic. Nobody comes, you know, to park a cruiser halfway down to remind people to slow. That speed sign, I cannot remember when it was last utilized. Weeds are overgrowing on it. Once upon a time, the police parked a temporary sign, radar monitor, in a neighbor's driveway. And that was all we have received from the city for help with the traffic. So we've gotten to the point, as they said, we stop complaining. If the permit is allowed to proceed open-ended, again, this is our fear. It's just going to expand out now. Since they really didn't have the permit in the first place, who's to say, okay, well, we're going to allow it because it's there. We're going to allow it because it's there. And the next thing you know, it's going to take a tragic accident before somebody notices it's gotten out of hand. And it is well out of hand already.
Anybody else?
My name is Tom Douglas. I live in Northampton. I live on Crescent Street. I have a business downtown. And this year was the first year that I coached on the Northampton Soccer Club. I didn't really have to be educated by the club about the traffic problems on Island Road. If you've read the paper for the last 10, 15 years, you understood what was going on. Although the first thing they told me when I joined the club were the regulations that we had to follow when we had a game down there. We don't have any practices at all down there. We practice at Jackson Street. We've had, I think, out of the 10 games probably we had in the spring, we had two at the Oxbow. And one of the things that I was expecting when I went to an Oxbow game was that there would be bumper-to-bumper traffic and people would be speeding. And I found that the times that I went down there, it was twice in the spring, twice in the fall, I was the only car. I couldn't see another car in front of me or another car behind me. I was the only car on that road going to a game. So I was really flabbergasted that, first of all, there was almost no traffic, none that I could see till you get to the parking lot. The second thing that I was surprised about was I knew that we were supposed to carpool starting from a designated spot at the beginning of Island Road. And there were no cars there when I drove in. But what happens is we have games, most of our games are out of town. We play in Ware, Palmer, West Springfield, all over the place, and a lot of the places are like an hour away. Everybody gets used to carpooling to those places. Most of the parents don't want to go to every game. They don't want to drive their individual kid to an individual game. So people carpool, and the carpool starts at home. It's a whole lot easier to start your carpool at home than it is to start to meet down there, try to have a meeting time, wait in your car, for someone to come to pick you up when you can be sitting at your house waiting for two or three families to bring their kids to your house at their leisure, at your leisure. Then you pack up all the people in your car from your house and then your carpool and you go down to the field to play. So I think that one of the, like I said, the shocking things that I saw was there weren't any cars parked in the carpool lot. And I quickly found out it's because people don't, it's inconvenient to do it from there. And it's very convenient to do it in your house. So one of the shocking things about this season, though, was that Ultimate Frisbee event. Because we had a game there that day, and I could barely find a parking space in that whole big parking lot there because it was full of the Frisbee people. It was just jam-packed. So that must have been a very difficult event for the neighbors to go through. I can't imagine the traffic that came because of that event. But basically, I think that sports, soccer, is really important to kids' development. And the Northampton Soccer Club has a great environment. It's educational, it's very organized. We've always gotten notices about what we should and shouldn't do on the Oxbow fields. We don't practice there, my kids don't. We have very few games there. And I think that the fields there really are a big part of the success of the club. I don't think the club can move forward. They're not growing, they're staying steady. But they're staying steady and being successful and helping a lot of kids in Northampton. I think that the Oxbow fields are really critical to the success of the club. So I hope that you vote to continue soccer down there. And we're only asking for four fields, two little fields and two big fields. It's not a big expanded soccer arena like everybody keeps talking about. So this is a very limited amount of space that's dedicated to soccer down there. Thank you.
Tom, you mentioned you don't practice there, but Mark, you in your presentation, you referenced that other teams do practice during the week?
Yes.
Anybody else that hasn't spoken yet?
I just to point out about the
anybody else has it, you can jump back in after a second. But anybody back here? No?
Okay. Yep. Hi, Adam Bass on 99 Island Road. I think I don't have a lot to say. I've only been there about 2 years. My partner Catherine and I lived together there. And I think what I'd like you to consider is dead end streets and traffic counts by comparison. Any dead end street in North Hampton, take a traffic count, and it'll be a tenth or less of what we're seeing. The road is in terrible shape. Potholes are just patched every year. When boat traffic goes by, the house rattles due to the poor conditions of the road. And when the soccer traffic is there and a yacht is coming, it's common from what I've seen. I don't have a lot to say. I personally have sat out front and watched, and I do not see a lot of carpooling. I honestly don't. And oftentimes it's one kid in the back seat with a mom or dad in the front. I get it. Everybody's busy. They're on their ways. They're doing this. But when you look at the traffic counts, you'll see these pattern flows on Island Road, and I would say during the soccer days, it's probably 90% of the traffic we see on the road that day is from the soccer. And they're in short bursts of east and westbound at the same time. And that's what we're seeing. It's impossible for us to walk our dogs. People do break the speed limit. Speed bumps would be great. Repaving would be great. Traffic, cops, slowing people down would be great. Anything would be better than what we're seeing. I appreciate you listening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I know we're all tired. I forgot. One concern that I had, and this actually happened a few years ago when Mr. Hasbrook was first taking over as building inspector, and there has been use of fields that they weren't supposed to be using. That does happen, and he was with me. We were just meeting there, and he was the one that said, they're on those fields that they're not supposed to be on. So, I don't mean to be nasty and accusatory, but that, and I have witnessed that, you know, and I don't know, like he knew that day. I wouldn't have known that because this was the last little thing that I wanted to say was, I touched on it, but just because I think it's really important to hear that we, like Catherine said, we have been there from the beginning. So this is wearing at us. And so sometimes I feel like giving up. I really do. Like when I first thought about this meeting, part of me was just like, why bother? But so I just wanted to say that just because, you know, maybe I'm not as good as sending official emails and calling people and complaining, because after so many times of doing that with nothing, with people saying things that didn't happen, it gets frustrations. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. If I may, there's two teams practicing down there this evening. Two fields of big uniforms. As of 6 o'clock.
As of 6 o'clock, when?
This evening, before coming downtown.
I'm Helen Kahn. I live at 188 Federal Street in Florence. I've been involved with NSC as a coach for, I think, 3 years now. I've been with the Oxbow quite a bit. We absolutely would love to be able to practice or play somewhere else. Obviously, if there are fields available, as Mark Tanner pointed out, it's difficult to get to the Oxbow for us. And in fact, I'm the team that he alluded to that we often will practice at Ames Field in Williamsburg because it's just more convenient for for people to get there. However, those fields are not available to us. Fields that are available to us are at the Oxbow right now. I've actually had a similar experience to that Tom Douglas said that, and I don't think the residents are making it up, but you know, obviously they are there, they've been there for 11 years and they've seen the traffic. I know from personal experience when I go, the road itself is a traffic calming measure. I mean, if you try to drive down that road, I remember commenting to the kids in my car, you know, I think 20 miles an hour is too fast, because like whenever I look at my speedometer, I'm at like 10 or 15, because you try to go very slowly, and if there are any other cars, you're going to go slowly. So I'm surprised and disheartened to hear that people are speeding on that road. Certainly I agree that if there's something else that can be done to slow them down. I don't remember if there's a traffic sign at the beginning. I know someone talked about that. Like when you go in, there certainly should be, you know, a posted speed limit there. Because if you're not familiar with the road, maybe you go faster. As soon as you're familiar, you're going 10 miles an hour, maybe 15 miles an hour there. You know, if we are to continue playing there, which we really need to do, so certainly I hope that we're approved to continue playing there. There are some reasonable requests that I think we should comply with, like giving people the game schedule and things like that. If that would be helpful to the residents, I don't see why that can't be done, because that's something that we get at the beginning of the season. And certainly if I were living there, I'd want to know, you know, when are the times that people are going to be practicing there, what are the times that they're going to be playing there. Certainly I'd want to know if there's a huge ultimate tournament, but I know that's another issue that, you know, we didn't really cause. So I guess, you know, that's my input. I think, you know, what we've said is true, that the coaches and the players and the teams that have been down there and using the fields, we do end up carpooling because nobody wants to drive down to the Oxbow. And I think we should think about what we can do for these teams that are coming from out of town. As Mark Tanner said, there is the league itself does make it really clear every time you go to a field, they tell you the restrictions of the field, so they put out that email. I wish I had a perfect solution for how we could make them all carpool. You know, I understand the concern on that, but I would say NSC really very much appreciates being able to use those fields. All those hundreds of kids over the years who are using those fields really appreciate that we can use those fields. We're not going to intentionally do anything to damage that. You know, we don't want it to go away. So we're doing all we can to make it easier for the residents there. And if there's more we can do, I think, you know, we should discuss as a club what we can do.
Thank you. Anybody else? Any comments from the board?
Can I ask some questions? Carolyn, I'm confused. This is an application by the applicant, the Northampton Soccer Club. But do I understand there's also a number of other teams or organizations or groups or individuals playing sports in the same area, and plus all the marina activity, which is separate? But I don't understand why this organization needs to apply for a permit if there are a bunch of other organizations already using it.
I don't know about the other organizations using it. I do know about the one-time ultimate tournament.
Well, other than that one time, I think, yeah, right.
So the reason, going back to 2007, why this kicked up to a special permit for the club was when it came in as a joint permit with Western United, because it was viewed at that time that there was an expansion of sort of the pre-existing accessory use. So the option would be either to come and get a separate special permit because outdoor recreation is allowed in this district, or the other side of the argument would be to go to the zoning board to get a review for expansion use. But so at that time it kicked into special permit. I'm not aware of any regular official organizations that are using the fields, but that's not to say that someone doesn't just call up the property owner and say, hey, can I come down and use your fields? We wouldn't necessarily know about that. So I don't know about that.
Well, there were references, and another part of my confusion is the mention of using the field for practice or not. Apparently, some groups, some younger kids do use it for practice, but not the...
I think it was, I heard the other way around, but I think originally there, so when Western United came in with the Northampton Soccer Club for the permit, there was a very specific schedule about how many practices each team could have, and one team had more use of the fields in the fall versus the spring. So at that time, there was a whole evaluation of how many practices were granted per week, how many games per week, and then that got modified slightly through when the special permit came back after the 2007 original one. That was sort of the genesis of determining, you know, who could use what and when. I think that also was the beginning of sort of let's evaluate what the traffic impacts are, let's evaluate what the speeds are. The city actually conducted a speed survey there as well, because there was a whole request for traffic calming. Traffic calming is about speed, not about volumes. So the only way you can really evaluate whether traffic calming is appropriate is if you do a speed study. In 2008, we actually had the data for the speeds, and there really wasn't a whole lot of speeding. The 85th percentile of the driver, the number was 25 miles per hour, and posted at 25 miles per hour. I just pulled up Google Earth, and there's a speed limit sign that says 25. So 95% of the vehicles were going 29 miles per hour or less. That was 2008, so you know, maybe people have sped up since then, but certainly conditions of a road would sort of limit how fast you can go. And so those are sort of built-in traffic calming. But again, sort of going back to that, that's the whole reason for the request for the speed board that was originally put up, the traffic counts that were required for those seasons, was because there was a concern now with a sort of expansion of having these two major clubs playing there all the time, that we need to get some data about what was happening and when, what were the results. And,
So how come the marina isn't the ones coming in for the permit? Why is it, I mean, so you could essentially have multiple clubs coming in asking for a permit and renting. It'd be like somebody downtown rents coming in.
Basically, that's it.
Well, that's what it is. So, you know, a tenant comes in for the permit for their use. And we haven't had any requests from any other organizations. And I think in evaluating this permit request, I think you can very specifically grant a permit to an individual organization, and then that wouldn't allow other organizations to piggyback onto that permit. So it could be granted to one permit holder, and then anyone else that might be doing a separate use that's not considered accessory to a marina would have to come in for their own permit.
But that is where we end up with sort of multiple, where you lose continuity, and so the person that comes in, essentially, you could forget what was already talked about.
Every 3 years, the kids are older, there's a whole new rotation of parents. Yeah. They've heard of something, but they don't know specifically. And it's not so bad when I drop off my little Timmy to, you know, what's the big deal? And then, you know, this, so they just don't see it. This has been an ongoing thing. But it's not about the merits of soccer or how good it is. We've been to meetings where the kids were in full uniform with the, you know, don't take my soccer away and things like that. It has nothing to do with soccer. It has nothing to do. It's all traffic. It's all it is traffic. It's always been about traffic.
So how do the traffic, so what's the most recent traffic count?
This spring. From 2014.
Was the spring. Mm-hmm. And so how is that used? Who looks at that? And then what's a comparison? Just like just a value doesn't
right.
mean.
So we've been collecting the data, and as was mentioned by Mr. Remillard, we've really had spring counts for the most part, and I believe that was the case because that's the heaviest season, and Mark can correct me if I'm wrong, but we've just been taking the counts, and until they come back for a permit, we're not really doing anything with it. But when you compare it, when you look at the data, there's two points on the road where the counters are set up. So you can see the traffic for the neighborhood plus the traffic going to the marina. The only traffic we don't really know about is marina versus soccer, although these were done in late April, so there's probably not a whole lot of marina traffic at that point in the season. And it's about a 50-50 split, a little bit more than 50% are soccer. And so the numbers, you just look at and you see for that segment, 50% of all the trips on the road are going to the marina, but it's spread out over the course of an entire day, for a weekend day, for example. So if you're talking about 300 trips, it's really from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. for the most part. There's a little sprinkling there, here and there. And then, of course, for the weekdays, the time period is later in the afternoon, as opposed to spread out so much during the day. But then we look at that, and it would only come up in relative to, permitting. Does it make sense to continue collecting this data? And what is it telling us in terms of volume? So if you compare to other streets in Northampton, it's still very low compared to many side streets. And over the years, we've collected traffic counts for different streets. And I sent you all a spreadsheet of some, sampling of just some streets. So, even some of the side streets, Lincoln Avenue, Union Street, Grove Street, 700-900 trips, average trips per day. That's the very low end. And then for the most part, we're well up over 1,000, 1,700 trips on many, many of the other city streets in Northampton. So it's still considered relatively low, very low actually, as compared to neighborhood streets throughout the city.
I guess it's the width of this street that makes it seem much worse.
There are a lot of issues that don't have anything to do with soccer that come into play here. And the condition of the road, the construction of the road, the width of the road, the traffic calming, the speed limits, all of that, it's just one element after another. And the soccer club is just one more thing. But it's the only thing right now that the residents can control, because that's what's up in front of us. And so the sense I've gotten over the years is it's not the soccer club that's putting everybody over the edge and just driving everybody crazy. It's just an element that they might be able to control, although there's been frustration over the years that they're not, nothing's being controlled. And it's gotten better since that other soccer club went. And I think what happened before was had two soccer clubs generating a lot of traffic, and what happened was some people were saying where a parent would drop their kid off, go to Dunkin' Donuts, come back, and then go again. And so you could have potentially four trips per kid, per team, and it was crazy, times two teams. But then that second team left, and it got better, and it got noticeably better from feedback with that. But it didn't go away, and it's a relative thing. It got better, but if you're starting at a point where you're already frustrated, better is a relative term. So, but the only thing we have tonight is the Northampton Soccer Club, and what we had a problem with in the past was we appreciated the concerns of the residents, wanted to address that, but had to address it through the soccer club. And so we said, all right, we can carpool, we can do this, we can do that, but so many of those things were hard to enforce. So I think collectively we need to, if it's going to go forward, we need to come up with something that is finite and enforceable. And I don't know that the traffic, I think before they were supposed to do traffic counts spring and fall, and they did in the spring. But the traffic counts have shown over the years that in comparison to other roads in Northampton, it is a low-use road. That doesn't help the people that live on the road, but comparable.
But we have the time series data, which I'm assuming probably shows very sharp spikes,
right.
Which is different than a lot of roads,
right.
With the exception maybe of Massachusetts.
Fair Street or something like that.
The Y, where you have a lot in the morning and a lot in the afternoon. But you're going to have lots of cars going by, which I think makes it different.
That's what I think when the games are over.
then you can see everybody queued up. Because I used to be down when my kids were little, so I was down there as well.
One other question for you guys. Is weekends noticeably worse than maybe, I'm assuming with the marina traffic, that's where it gets built on, or is that not really the case, and so it doesn't really matter?
I think weekends are worse, and the biggest thing is that, in my personal opinion, the traffic counts are conducted at a time of year when those fields are flooded, so you're not getting an actual great picture. If they were done in an off flood time of the year, like if we compared it to the fall, I mean, I understand the number of games may be different, but over the years, it's been during flood season. So we have a spike for a certain period of time, but it's not showing, you know, really great information.
Could I just address that? I'm sorry.
Yep.
The part of the reason that there's the two sets of fields is because the lower fields that are actually by the river, where the tennis courts are, those fields flood in the spring. Can't dispute that at all. The upper fields don't flood at all, and they're not as good a quality as a field. And so when we did this traffic study in the spring, we intentionally did it when we did, because the marina wasn't yet really in action, and really the only thing that was going on at that point in time was us. And so if there was a week or a 2 week period of time that would really work well to do a traffic study, because you're really excluding the marina traffic, this was the week to do it. And so when I sent that to Carolyn, one of the days is an outlier, because I think it was Easter, that Sunday, April 20th, was a holiday of some sort. But all the other days of the week were regular business, and that Sunday would have been exactly the same traffic pattern as Saturday. There wouldn't have been more or less games in that area on a Sunday as opposed to a Saturday.
Also, our schedule is regulated by the Pioneer Valley Youth Soccer League, so when they say you start your season, you have to start. You know, there's no question about it. So whether the field is flooded or not, which it hasn't been down there when the season starts, it's not like a field is flooded and we don't use it. It's the season starts and we have to be there. So if the traffic counts are scheduled when the season started, you're going to get the regular season counts.
What makes it hard for me is that it's at the times when I'm finally home and can enjoy my property. And as I said, from there to there, that's my living room. There's my front porch. You know, it's like I can't walk the dog. I can't sit on the porch. I can't go in my bedroom because it's on the roadside. I can't go in the living room. I mean, it's like it's so in my face when I come home at the hours when the kids are playing. And then the weekends, those are exactly the times when I want a little peace, but.
One is the, I don't know how the ultimate tournament came about, but that certainly seems like it was an oversight and probably should be addressed.
Mike, I can probably explain that if you want me to.
Well, I was just going to say, probably should be addressed before next year, because I understand it was very successful from their perspective, right, so it's probably going to be happening again. So, but it seems like that was, that seems outside of the tournament, right? A couple questions. One is, from a technical standpoint, the marina has permission for an accessory use, which is soccer.
No.
No,
the marina came in, got a permit in 70 whatever as a marina of a certain size, and they never came back. So the marina itself has expanded without coming back for permits.
And then
other uses have come along. So soccer came along at some point, maybe in the 80s.
Okay. Second kind of technical question is then, has this permit lapsed?
No.
But I saw the date June 30th, 2014, in a couple of these emails. That's what I'm trying to understand, which we are, of course, now passed.
So it was due to expire, but it was extended because of the Permit Extension Act. I thought you meant going back.
But I thought that meant that that extension expired on June 30th.
Yeah, I don't remember the exact date. If it was supposed to be June. So if that's the case, then we're into the right. So they wouldn't be able technically to start up in the fall without a permit.
Okay. So,
but they're not playing now. It's a spring and fall.
Okay. But there's not a permit currently in force. because the old one is last and the new one hasn't been initiated in order to just make.
So there's no use of it by the soccer club or any other soccer organization now?
Well, for permit, technically, they had an expiration date because that's how it was originally granted, so that the board would have the opportunity to review. So at the end of the expiration date, then.
Which has already passed by.
Right.
So what's the, so there is or there is not soccer being played there now?
I'm not aware of the schedule, so I don't.
Sounds like soccer. We are not playing soccer there. I can tell you that there, and my understanding is this is all included through the building inspector, there are teams associated with Northampton High School, which are using the soccer field. It's the building inspector's opinion that the Dover Amendment, which is the same way the Ultimate Frisbee guys got there, allows the high school to use that because the high school soccer teams are an educational purpose.
Well, it's not Dover actually. It's the way the Frisbee was granted was it's a municipal use, it's a municipal function. And so by zoning, City of Northampton.
Can you explain that? I'm sorry, I don't understand. Can you kindly explain that to me? Because it doesn't make sense. If it's privately owned by the marina, how does a municipality get to utilize it for whatever purpose? I'd really like to know.
Because the City of Northampton can hold a function, there aren't restrictions on the use of property for municipal purposes.
But it's owned by a private entity, it's not owned by the city.
Right, it doesn't matter about the ownership, it's the use.
So you could take my parcel of property across the street and do whatever you wanted with it without my permission?
No, the city received permission from the property owner.
Okay.
And said, yes, you can use these fields. Because it was a city function, they can use the field.
So
if it's a private function, it would be required.
So that's the sentence Mr. Hausberg used about educational usage?
That's what different. There are two parts to it. If you were an educationally exempt use and you weren't part of the municipality, you might still be able to use the field. But because it's a city function, then the city can use the field.
So understanding that, if any high school team or any city function, whatever, Mr. Duda said, yes, you can hold this, it doesn't matter, they can just do whatever they want, or you could have 1,000 people down there at some big event, like if they chose to do the family fourth thing there instead of at the Cliff Park.
Right.
Could I ask a quick question? I forgot to bring this up. I'm not sure that, I mean, my mom used to be on the Conservation Commission, and there was an awful lot of stuff that went on down there that was literally illegal. Like, it's because it's a wetlands. It's we can't really build on it. We're not supposed to. So I just wanted to throw that out there. I realized that, that's just another thing that doesn't even get in the middle of all the traffic. Nobody even, maybe the zoning is like, there's way too, I don't know, just no one's mentioned that.
Okay, we can try to bring this back to the issue at hand, Carl.
So, I'm sorry, I thought I understood it, but you raised the question. I thought I understood the answer, but so the owner is using the field in ways that he did not present when he was here for establishing.
Right.
Marina.
Right. It was just a marina at the point that at which he received the variance.
So that
in
seems like an obstacle to me.
Well, except the zoning has changed since then.
Okay.
So the zoning now allows by special permit commercial outdoor recreation use. So at the time he came in under a different zoning code. Now we require special permits for these uses.
Okay,
so,
and it's special permits by the organizations themselves.
Whatever they, right. It wouldn't necessarily stipulate that, but it makes sense. But it is sort of just like if you have a building mm-hmm. and you have separate tenants, then each of your tenants, you could come in on behalf of your tenants, or you could have your tenants come in for a permit.
Except, I get stuck right back where you mm-hmm. just started. It started out, they were not because they were not allowed to have that use. And it seems...
But a special permit was granted in 2010, so now they were allowed that use. Now that permit has lapsed, and it's back in front of the city. So we're back. I forget what's happening. This is where we are.
Yeah, right.
Where we got to...
And the zoning still allows this heavy use by special permit.
And I think a lot of the frustration, I think if the only traffic generated by the MSC was what we're discussing tonight, it would be a short discussion. But when you have the high school playing there and the residents don't know about it and ultimate frisbee tournaments, and I know my son's played lacrosse down there before. And so all these things, and I don't know that they're asking permission or getting permission or just going down because the fields are empty. But as a resident with your front porch 15 feet away, all you see are cars. You don't know who they belong to, what MSC or anybody else. And the yachts, right. And so, but all that we have tonight is the Northampton Soccer Club. And so that's what we need to...
But if we deny this, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. Well, I was just going to suggest you close public hearing.
Let's keep it until we're done talking. Are you going to say that?
If we deny the soccer club, we're not denying this use for all others that want to use it at the property, or are we? So it's just the soccer club.
Right, so someone might come in and use it.
But they still have to come in.
Right.
Except for the city.
Theoretically, right.
Also theoretically, the Florence Fields should mitigate this issue. Because I remember in 2010, it was wait, at that point, Florence was just an idea. Nobody even knew where these fields were going to come from. But they said, if in the future, Northampton gets more fields, Oxbow traffic will be solved, that issue. And though, to Mark's point, they can't say, well, when those fields come online, we want those fields, because the city will dictate who gets what. But you would think, with three or four more fields added to the mix, that maybe they won't get the best fields, Ellerbrook Field or whatever, but they might get a field that they right now can't get at because the high school is playing there, or JFK or whatever. So you would think it has to help. It has to.
Can I ask Mark a question?
Yeah.
So is the Northampton Soccer Club a tenant of the marina?
In a sense, we don't actually pay rent. We pay him to mow the grass and to line the fields. So in the sense that we pay him in order to use the space, he does something for us. Yes, you can consider us a tenant.
So to go back to what you were saying, if we were to deny, it doesn't mean that the soccer club couldn't come back, but it would mean that everybody needs to come for each use to get a permit, unless they're falling
already.
Right. But we don't affect this, what the city does at all.
Because the other events have been the city, the municipal, have fallen under the municipal.
And also we can't, apparently all these other uses are occurring without permit. So it's not like we can deny something that doesn't come before the board.
Right. Well,
I feel that if we deny the special permit to the Northampton Soccer Club, there's still going to be issues for the residents of that street.
Right.
That is not going to solve.
No, it'll solve this piece of the puzzle. But I mean, it seems like no matter what, that discussion has to happen. In the past 10 years, it's had to happen about traffic. Somebody please fix the road, and can we get a speed monitor or whatever? But that, right now, I don't think that is specific in and of itself to NSC. Right. I think it plays a part.
But this is a precedent. I mean, it would be more difficult to deny a future permit application if we accept.
Not necessarily. No, this is by itself. So you would look at all the uses at that location. So let's say if the lacrosse club comes and says, hey, I want a permit for the Expo too. In your evaluation, you'd be looking at, when does the lacrosse team want to use it?
you know, is it the same season? Is it, if it is the same season, what days? And does that just kick the traffic levels to an untenable, you know, level? Sorry, soccer was already in the door, you don't get your permit. You know, there's nothing that binds you to grant another permit to the next one in line.
Sure. Right.
And it seemed like whatever that threshold is, in 2010, we were over that threshold as far as angst and frustration with the two soccer clubs and the traffic generated. It was just, it was too much. Now that other soccer club's left, and I don't have a sense if we're below that threshold, or it's just added, or what, but it's, you know, it's bad.
It seems like it's getting replaced with city use and non-special permitted use.
In a sense,
which
yeah.
Which is on the rise.
And right.
It seems, you know, that wasn't part of the original equation. Yeah, it seems.
But nor is it part of tonight's discussion.
Well, it is. It has to be, because the special permit is in the context of all the activities that are happening.
Right, but if those other activities aren't happening, are happening.
We can't affect those, but we can.
But if they're happening, if they shouldn't be happening in the arc, then it's hard to argue we're going to deny this because everybody else, you're trying to do something legally where everybody else is doing it illegally, or you know what I mean?
But why,
where
how do you, come there's no enforcement against the marina?
That's a different discussion. Yeah, but, I agree.
But is that, so whose purview does that fall under? And does our actions actually impact what does take place in that regard? So if we deny a special permit for this use, is there actually some more leverage for enforcement of the unpermitted uses that are occurring?
I would say it has no relationship. It's an enforcement issue, and it could be that people aren't getting permission, or it could be they're getting permission and the property owner says, sure, it's just a one-time, one-off thing, go ahead, use my field, I don't mind. Then they're in and out, and then there's no, you know, the building commissioner could enforce, take enforcement action after the property owner, but it's one of those things that it, I would say it is hard to enforce. It's not unenforceable, but it's more difficult if it's a one-off thing and there's a quick, you know, handshake.
Right, and that would be different. You know, a pickup game versus an organized,
right,
you know, weekend.
But absolutely, if there's an order, you know, and the other thing is you can't take into consideration the city functions, because that could happen anywhere. It could happen again, at whether this permit's granted or not. So, you know, I think that becomes more of a political question of city councilors to say, okay, should we be putting these fields to greater use for municipal good or municipal functions, or should we not?
I just had a question. You had indicated previously that the zoning had changed at the fields. According to the 2011 permit that was issued, PB special permit intermediate, it says SC 100 in parentheses. So did it change from that point?
No, I'm talking historically in the 70s. From when the marina was initially permitted, it didn't come in as a special permit, it came in as a variance.
Okay.
So since that time that the variance was granted, we now have special permit for that kind of use.
And how you mentioned the Western United leaving and the traffic going down, this specifically from 2011, after Western United had been gone for about a year, it said the applicant may only schedule games in the fields of no practices even after they had been. I just wanted you to know.
No, I'm aware of that.
What did you say? I didn't hear you.
Games only, no practice.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
I just didn't hear what you said.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the ways to limit activity is to cut the fields back. You know, say 2 fields.
Is it, you can cut the fields back, you can cut before, it was a requirement, no games, no practices during the week, only games. And, but that wasn't enforced and that wasn't done.
And so
that is being done.
And I guess that's especially because, Mark, you've given a good historical perspective, even though I've also lived here for about 11 years and we've taken our kids. And I guess that's where I'm having trouble, is it seems that, at least previously under the permits, and maybe this is why it continued to be a discussion, is in some ways we've asked a private nonprofit to perform a municipal function, which is controlling, and to me that seems a little bit like where we've gotten this conundrum, which is, you know, we put these conditions, which then turned out to be unenforceable because they're not, you know, they're kind of municipal functions of police and speeding and, you know, all those things, and yet we're putting it on somebody who can't do it. So that's the part I'm in trouble with, is that we're, you know, what is our ability to, we can't tell the city to, we can't put the condition on that's the municipal's function because they're not the applicant. That is a private nonprofit that's trying to do what they do. I mean, that's, you know, that's what nonprofits do. So that's where I'm having trouble, you know, especially, you know, thinking about it, as Mark explained, the historical part.
Yeah, I mean, I think it makes sense to think about, if you all think that the use is too intense as described, not necessarily as permitted, but as the request for two, you know, four fields total, that the traffic counts, I don't think, make sense anymore. We've got the data, there's nothing really being done with it, it's just an expense. The city did do the traffic counts and the speed study originally, to sort of, you know, create a foundation for that. So I think there may be other ways to put permit conditions on, and to obviously to continue to encourage carpooling. I think the shuttling is really, doesn't work, it's not enforceable, and it's just not the way people operate and function. People are coming from different locations, and you're sitting there waiting for someone to come. So I don't think that makes sense in terms of conditions, but other things that you suggested, like limiting the fields or...
I don't think limiting,
saying practices versus games during a certain period necessarily makes sense either, because you might be, you know, if you had a game, but it got canceled, but you still want to have a practice, does that count?
Well, I mean, it's just, it's concerning to me, is that was one of the original conditions, and it was ignored. I mean, that would be a bad faith gesture from the soccer club.
I think originally, and I think part of that is because of the turnover, you know, as the kids progress and the parents are with their kids. In 2010, they're, you know, at the Oxbow, they're not playing at the Oxbow in 2014, and so they've moved on. But from using the carpool, using the parking area, to games only, to what was the other one talking about? There were two or three things. Oh, that the traffic report, spring and fall, that just weren't done. And so, as far as a good faith effort, there were, depending on who was leading the charge of the soccer club, there were good faith efforts to try to. And I think people are well intended to try to do what they can, but the permit was based on certain criteria, and some of those criteria weren't met. And so if we're going to do this again, I don't think we should just go back to the same criteria and say, let's try it again, because we've been trying it for 12 years,
right,
and it's not working.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chair, could I just say something?
Yeah.
I mean, the one thing that we've tried to brainstorm this too, as to what can we do to deal with these things. And the one idea that we came up with that we've never implemented, but that makes some amount of sense, is issuing parking passes at the start of the season. And once again, it's a self-regulated thing, but if you issue 10 parking passes a team, then you know for a team of 18 kids, you're not going to have more than 10 cars there. But what it would require on our part is to have somebody, the coach, somebody down there, looking in the window to see if they have a parking pass, and implementing some sort of internal fine policy within the club if you don't have one. Once again, it's the same sort of prisoner's dilemma. It's us enforcing a rule, but at least it's something where there's a visual component to it that's arguably at least enforceable.
Can I ask you how that would work for other, so you're part of your own team, so the visiting team? So
yeah, I don't think you could for the visiting team.
But, and then on the other hand, you know, I mean, I think it would pose a dilemma anyway. Say every parent on the team wants to go to the game.
Then it forces them to carpool, assuming that it's enforced. And I can tell you, I would know what we could do to enforce it, but once again, yeah, it's an imperfect
system. That's a hard time with it before. I think it's a great idea, but unenforceable.
Yeah. I just want to reiterate that this is a dead-end road. You are speaking about through traffic roads. I don't believe you mentioned any roads where you have to go to the end, turn around, and come back out. It's much different than a through traffic road. So traffic comes on a road like ours should basically be the residents, the marina, and maybe some soccer traffic. But it's, so by comparing what you said earlier, it doesn't make sense. So if you had traffic counts on some dead-end roads in Northampton, I'd be curious if they were anywhere near that, which is what we see.
It's different though, a standard dead-end road versus like, say, Fair Street, where there's a destination at the end of the day.
Sure, right.
That's what we have here.
Right.
We've got a dead-end road with the Oxford, and so it's just, it's
would there be a traffic count for Fair Street to compare it to?
We might have one. Yeah, I can look and see.
You know, I don't understand the whole idea of the traffic count, unless I just don't plain don't understand it. What is the idea to count how many traffic, soccer related, well, let me be more specific. It's the idea to count how many Northampton Soccer Club soccer vehicles there are, or all vehicles? I mean, what if it's a high school team or the marina that's generating all the traffic? And here we are debating the traffic from the club.
The intent was for the club. That was club specific, knowing that you can't 100% distinguish that. All the traffic we're reading.
Not even 50% or 40, I mean, I don't know.
Right, so it's ambiguous.
I think that's why they did it in April before there was big marina traffic.
Right. To Mark's point, at one point that they could say, the only thing happening, if there wasn't any Oxbow traffic, the only traffic you could argue were residents and soccer club.
Or the high school.
Right.
But some other traffic counts are in May around Memorial Day. So, I mean, you can't really say each spring it's been consistent at the early time of the season. So I think they're inconsistent. If they did them at the beginning and we knew, for example, to coordinate with the schedule to show, all right, you know, Mr. Tanner presented, this is the day we have this game, here's the traffic for that day. And you could see how it, you know, how it played out, and you would have a comparison versus, you know, in 2010, it was May 25th, that's Memorial Day time frame. Are there even any soccer games, or were they trying to point out that that's marina traffic? So you really don't have to look at us because we're so, you know, it's so minimal. So that's my thought.
I agree to a certain extent, but I think the data collected shows you kind of just blur your eyes, look at the bottom number, and you compare that bottom number to other low traffic streets in the city. From the city's perspective, they'd say it might be a pain for people who live there, but it on a citywide level, it's not a heavily traffic street.
But those are average numbers, right?
Right.
Average
out of the day. Right. And we've got peaks for every game. Right?
And the way it was described is it really is.
It's not
counting what's going to the field, and so you've got these, you know, 300, if it's 600 in a day, it's, you know, it's 300 for the first hour and 300 for the second. So
there's nothing that's anywhere near 600. I mean, well, the highest traffic count on the Saturday in an
so
hour.
To me, that's what
49.
That's what we could limit, whether it's by what happens during the weekday or how many fields they get or whatever. You can limit the traffic count by how many. By what's happening at the end of the road, how many fields you have to plan, or when you can plan. So, I think we've kind of exhausted all these points. Is there anything else that anybody wants to say before we close public?
For all these years, I have just watched things not get carried through that were agreed upon in good faith by the soccer club. Like, yes, we're going to do this, and it's refreshing to hear Mr. Tanner say, "Well, you know, I don't know if this is." You know, we can do this, but I don't know. Is there no, like, even a little slap on the wrist? Like, there's no repercussion for all these years. Like,
well,
there's been many times that...
The repercussion is that we're here trying to come to a compromise with you. We're here at the table with you. We're not saying we are opposed to doing anything to help you. We recognize that it is a problem. So we're all here trying to discuss how we can deal with this, how we can both get what we want, and it seems to be practically impossible to do that. But I think we both have valid needs. So.
The only comment that I'd like to make towards that is, Catherine has a good point. You mentioned they have not met the conditions that were specifically given for 2007.
to the 2011. They were grandfathered in with the agricultural extension with the MGL law. I'm sorry, I don't know what off the top of my head today. Extending the permit. Otherwise, we would have been here a few years ago to address this issue. But knowing that even after the ZBA issued the information or their opinion regarding the enforcement of that law that hasn't been done, I don't know, as Catherine said, what you could do other than terminating the permit to give them some repercussion. But in my personal opinion, and as Julia had mentioned, nothing seems to occur when they make violations. So what do you do even if they don't do this and you give them an open-ended permit, or you give them 3 more years and we end up back here again, or whatever the time frame, what happens? We, the neighbors, live there. They overturn. They have a new person or new people come in on a continual basis. Nothing happens, and we just end up here upset. Whoever's on the board gets to hear our grievances, and new people make new commitments, but no one has done what was required on the original permits going forward, ever.
But I question whether it's an egregious act of 20 kids that go down there and play soccer on an afternoon on a weekday.
Let's,
I mean, is that really an egregious act that requires a snap?
So can I just address that?
Yeah.
There's a process in place for you to make that grievance if you want to make that grievance, and that's to the building inspector. You file a request for an enforcement action. Or you just send me an email and say, Mark, car number XYZ is speeding. Okay?
But it's easy to enforce it.
But I'm sorry, but that's the process that's in place. That's the process that's in place under Mass Law. I didn't put that there. That's what the city adopted.
The comment should be to the board, and I think this is, we're getting a little antsy here. Anybody have anything to say that hasn't been said before that's unique to the discussion tonight? If not, we'll close public discussion and let's get through this thing. No?
So moved.
Second. All in favor? Okay, so public discussion has ended. So now we're going to have an internal debate and see what we can come up with.
Can I just ask Carolyn?
Yes.
And I know we talked about this a little bit, but I'm still not. Why is it that, is it Mr. Duda? Why is it that he's not involved in this at all? It seems like, I'm sorry, I'm not understanding that.
Yeah, it's not a complicated question necessarily. I mean, it's the way, you can do it in various different ways. You don't have to be as the property owner. You have to go and get permits for all the people that, you know, are renting from you or that you are using your space. It's just a choice that, you know, some people don't want to deal with going through the permit process. They say, okay, if you want to play here, get your own permit, that kind of thing. Same thing, I mean, we see that all the time, that the proponents, the people who want to use the space, come and ask permission. And sometimes they come in front of you. You don't always see the property owner. Sometimes you see them because they're in support of the application, but they're not actually presenting the application to you. So I don't think that's something that you need to be concerned. It's a sign of some sort that the property owner isn't here asking for a permit.
It actually gives plenty of whoever some, not control is the right word, but some way to monitor how the building being used, versus if it was the owner.
Exactly.
Even just carte blanche.
I'm sure I agree to that.
Soccer, frisbee,
Or I agree that I'll do that, but then not really checking in with the actual end user. You might get into some conflicts. Here you've been able to have a conversation with the end user to know what works and what doesn't work.
Given, you know, everything that's been said, I think that the soccer club and whoever's been in charge of it the past years hasn't kept up to the permits because it's not enforceable.
Right.
So it's been faulty from the get-go. So we really need to, like I think it's been said, if this is granted, it's got to be ways to calm the traffic, which we haven't even gotten to yet. I guess there's some questions about reducing the amount of traffic, but in ways that it is enforceable so that the frustration of the neighbors can be met somewhere.
So what specific enforceable and reasonable restrictions could be imposed? Are there any?
I think there's two things. And I don't fault the current members of the club who are running the club. But history has shown that they haven't met the qualifications of the permit from past years. Those qualifications included, or have qualifications included, games only during the week, no practices, and the number of fields, too big, too small. So, too big fields, too small fields. We encourage carpooling. We can mandate that the schedules go out to everybody. But to me, it comes back, the two things that are enforceable are no practices during the week, and maybe one big field, one small field. That would be, that's something in between denying the permit outright and appeasing the residents to a certain extent and recognizing the fact that certain conditions in the past have not been met.
What about the idea that Mark Tanner himself suggested, limiting the number of parking places?
I think it's a great idea. I don't think it's enforceable.
Enforcement, well, that's true, except if the neighbors want to snoop around and find out that it's being denied. I mean,
what happened before, where people, when they had the parking lot, neighbors were taking pictures, and, you know, I can envision if you've got a couple kids in your car, and you're dropping off, and somebody's coming out of the woods taking your picture, counting people, you know, I just don't want to go anywhere near that.
Yeah.
And so, same thing with you don't want somebody walking by, hey mom, why is that person looking in your dashboard? Well, they're looking for your parking permit, and you just stuck a fine on your windshield, you know, that's not going to help anyone.
Well, the other thing, too, is that's not where it would stop. It would then, I mean, when that happened, then the residents would call, you know, the building department, who's the enforcement entity, because officially that's who needs to do the enforcement. But, you know, then that person has to schedule a time to go out, so then you pass the time where people
right,
are
it's already
saying,
occurred.
Yes,
right.
Exactly.
And then you don't, we really want the building official coming in, that's what happened before.
Right.
Said, I really don't want to go out there counting cars.
Setting up camp
lot.
All
right.
Saturday, is that really the best use of?
Right.
Well, how would they monitor that?
Yeah.
I'm not the enforcement officer, not my job.
How would the that department monitor, say, no games during or no practice during the week?
That I don't know that they would. I would say the residents would probably.
Well, but
say,
that
could
be
they
done
could, through. They could call in a complaint or saying it's Wednesday night and there's practice.
Well, that could be done through the scheduling. So if the schedules are sent out at the beginning of the season,
mm-hmm.
you could see, okay, here are the practice schedules. You know, maybe you don't know what team it is, but here are the days that are set aside for games.
Okay, and I guess with that, with anything else, as a citizen, if we're out, you know, in our neighborhood and we see something that isn't supposed to be happening, it falls on us to alert
right.
officials.
But I think instead of issuing a game schedule to the residents, it should be a game and practice schedule to the residents.
So can we require that as well?
Mm-hmm. And what's happened in the past is we required a lot of things and then just sat. And then people get frustrated and we're back here 4 years away. So I would say, the two firm conditions I would put would be no practice during the week, one big field, one small field, and a two-year permit extension. So, and instead of waiting 3 years, 4 years, 5 years for this to come up again, and then if it happens again, that's it. Because it seems like they've had one chance, two chances, four chances. But they're not the sole cause. I'm fully aware they're not the sole cause of the residents' frustrations, because from boat traffic to cross traffic to high school traffic to the width of the road, construction of the road, all those things have nothing to do with soccer. And it's always just been about traffic.
And then what about traffic calming?
So I'm
we're closed, Mark. Sorry.
Well, again, traffic calming is about speeds. Speed analysis that the city did does not show speeding that would warrant traffic calming. So the reason why, when applicants come forward to the Parking and Transportation Committee and ask, we need traffic calming, well, the first thing the DPW does is goes out and they have to conduct, you know, speed study to make sure it's warranted. So it was nowhere near being warranted the last time they did the analysis, and that was when Western United teams were there as well. So there's a lot more volume at that point. The other thing is, you know, the condition of the road, once you pave it, it's going to make it a lot better.
Whether we require more potholes.
Well, I mean, it's not to say the road shouldn't be improved. I mean, there, you know, you guys know, everyone knows there are dozens of streets in the city that need to be improved. But, you know, it's, I think that doesn't hurt.
I feel like really conflicted about it. I feel very empathetic towards the residents because it is like a dead end street. And to say that you can't enforce, I feel like, I get that like the shuttle is really hard, but I feel like there's a lot of opportunity to kind of revisit that. Like when you think about HOV lanes on a highway, like that's enforceable. Like can't this street be converted into a high occupancy street? The residents have stickers and there's a policeman who hands out tickets if you don't have four people. I mean, it seems like there must be some other way to, you know, I mean, looking at the satellite map again of that area, and I've been down the area a number of times, like, you know, it just seems like there's got to be some other way to get groups of people to this place that you know, some kind of spot where people from Hart can get down there. I mean, I don't know, I feel empathetic because I live next to a destination, and so, you know, if I had a schedule of rock concerts, it's kind of cold comfort to me to know when my night's going to be ruined. Like, I don't see that as really like a helpful thing for these people who are chose to live in what's not a neighborhood. It's just a street and then another little street, and it's, you know, right. There's not that expectation. I mean, it just seems like there's got to be something else that we can figure out to kind of reduce.
I just don't see how practically you can enforce that. And the only thing I would think would be the soccer club if you went down to, say, two big fields once more.
Right.
From two and two. And that they might say, okay, it's serious now. And if we screw up in the next 18 months, when we come up again, we're going to lose it. So we need to carpool. We need to. And it would be self-enforced,
right.
You know, versus having a cop down there because there's better use.
But the road can't be converted to a private street, like to a private way or anything?
That's not for us.
Sorry.
People are usually trying to go the other way.
Yeah.
True. I've lived on adjacent to a private street, and yeah. I would love for it to go the other way. But it's, I mean, that would create a different situation. Sorry.
We'll make a motion.
Okay.
I'll move that we approve it with the two conditions that Mark has suggested, and that it be no more than 2 years.
So the two conditions would be no practices during the week.
Right.
And
just the two fields, the too big and too small fields.
That's what they're looking for, is too big and too small.
Right. Well,
so that's the question to go to. If
we make it just 2 years, as you say, they'll know, don't come back.
Kind of enforce my question. I mean, when we talk about, you know, if they don't do that, you know, let's say that there's practices during the week. I mean, there has to be some process to say, okay, what has to happen? You know, does somebody have to submit like a signed affidavit that says we saw people practicing, and then it's immediate revocation? Or like, what's the, you know, is it just a phone call and a, you know, I mean, I think
if it keeps being violated and it's called in, then the building inspector can say,
so the can take the permit away. Just calling it in.
Right, because they can take the permit away because they're violating the special permit.
So there's nothing else other, I mean, I'm just saying we're not saying that it requires photographic evidence,
right.
Or, you know, it's just the phone call is the,
yeah, there's, and the revocation of the permit is probably is not what would happen. There would be fines.
Right, fines first, and then it would, yeah.
But so, what about sending the schedule of the games?
I think that should be a game and practice schedule. Like you say, it doesn't
necessarily
help.
I feel like it would be like,
well, the only thing I can see that,
you know,
if they're there a night that you, on your schedule, they're not supposed to be there, then at least that gets you that information.
Or what I can really see happening is it's posted on the refrigerator, and Tuesday night's supposed to be a free night, and they're happy, and all of a sudden there's a game, but it's not the Northampton Soccer Club. It's a high school, or it's lacrosse, or it's something. And I think a lot of that will come to bear that it's not necessarily soccer club. Right.
I'm sorry, was one of the conditions games only?
Games only during the week.
Period.
No practice.
Oh, just during the week. They could have practice on the weekend.
Yeah, usually from what we, usually we've heard that the other kids that are in other leagues, they practice twice a week. So they try to squeeze in one practice during the week and they play on the weekend. But they'll also have one game during the week. So to eliminate the noise of the practice, which this discussion we had 4 years ago, was no practices during the week. But that wasn't, that didn't happen and that wasn't enforced. So we've got no practices during the week. 2 years.
That's just a copy of the permit.
And also you said what you said that the schedule be distributed in
game
some
and practice schedule.
Yes.
Right. Should be made available to the residents. And how about the quantity of the fields?
They're asking for 2 and 2?
Yes. Or 2 and 1. I thought I heard Mark say 2 and 1.
2 and 2.
And then Tom said 2 and 2. But I also heard Mark say 2 and 2 would be more than enough.
Just going back, practices, not at all. Just games?
During
That's
the
what
week.
It was before, during the week.
During the week. So one of the unintended consequences here then would be on Saturdays, just, you know, it'll be jam-packed.
I don't think so, because I think that's when they, that's game day.
Game day.
Yeah,
but
and so there's no room to do games with all
four fields. Well, you know, if you have 2 and 2, it'll be all 4 fields, probably. Or maybe it's only all day anyway, it doesn't
right.
matter.
It's been a long, for everybody involved, the soccer club and the
it seems like under current, and I know you can't look at it this way, but given the current condition of the road and where it is and the use of that property, I think it would not happen without some significant change, infrastructure changes. But since it happened 30 years ago, it's there, we're stuck with it. But everything that continues to add to the use of that property is like an insult to injury at this point. That's
right, I agree, you know, but the soccer club would argue that they're not adding to it. They've been there for a long time, and it's better now than it was 3 years ago because the other group is there.
Worst thing in the world that could happen in the neighborhood, I would think, would be to repave the road. You ought to lobby against that ever happen.
So we have a.
As far as the fields, I don't know. I guess I feel like there should be some reduction.
I agree.
2 and 1. I mean that would be one.
So it's two big, two small. So we go 2 big, 1 small. 1 big, 2 small.
How does that,
or 1 and 1.
What is it for reducing?
It's to reduce the traffic.
Right.
Less fields, less places to play.
Right, but I mean, as far as coming up with this, is it big or is it small, like, I don't have any concept of how that would reduce.
Well, I would say 2 fields. Doesn't really matter.
1 big, 1 small.
Doesn't matter. Whatever 2 fields they want, 2 fields. Because why limit the size of it? It's not the size of it.
Right.
If they want bigger or small, that's fine.
Potentially, if we did that, I mean, I think this whole thing is a shame that we keep having this discussion every 3 or 4 years, but potentially if we did this and everybody did what they're supposed to do, in 2 years, the residents come back and say, oh, that was a big difference. And, you know, everybody's happy, and then maybe we ramp it back up to 3, you know, because everybody's, things have calmed down. Or maybe, you know, I don't know, we'll have that discussion in 2 years, but I think based on past history, we need to do something more than we've done in the past. And that, I think that's a good idea, 2 fields.
You know the status of the forms?
Out of rotation this fall, right? Back in, I think, next year?
Yeah, 2 fields.
On 2 growing seasons, which is the right way to do. Like Elderbrook Field, they did that the right way. It's the best field in the city, and it's so good that nobody plays on because they don't want to mess it up. So, but that's what they should do. And so what happens is the high school kids play on the best fields. And then it kind of trickles down. But if there are 3 or 4 more fields in the rotation, it's gotta help, you would think.
Mm-hmm.
it's reducing the field, number of fields to two, is that too punitive? Can we, even though discussion is closed, can we ask the applicant?
Potentially it would be, but again, this has happened. It's happened so many times over the years that good faith efforts have been made, there's no question, but there's also no question that stipulations that were made weren't effective.
Do we have to go to the point of actually identifying which fields are, I don't know how technical we have to get.
I think you can just say two fields.
Also the condition
fields. So we have a motion from Al, but we've got 2 years.
Can I just get a second on that?
No, two years, no practices during the week. Game and practice schedules, distributed residents, two fields. And do we say
no Sundays?
Do we say a good faith effort for carpooling, or does that go without saying? Because
I think there's no point putting something in that's totally, completely unenforceable.
Right. So is that it? Is that our motion? Alan, is that your motion?
That is.
Can I get a second?
We're still discussing it, 2 seconds.
Mm-hmm. I'll second it, but I would like to discuss one more thing. Mm-hmm. At the risk of being pelted with bad fruit. Is 2 years too long given the history? You know, how many swipes at the bat do you need to get? You know, given the history, why couldn't it be, 6 months? There'll be another season. Every season, there's two
spring
seasons
and fall.
A year.
So you want to get a full season, so maybe you could do that. Or then, so then you could argue.
You can say,
take that argument one step further. Do we, instead of going from 4 to 2, we go 4 to 3, but make it a year? Give them 3 fields, whatever they want, but make it come back in a year, and we'll have another 2.5 hour discussion. Is that a happy meeting?
A year's not that. I mean, they're going to have to start applying again in less than a year. It seems that you want to get a little bit more sort of on at the permit commissions to see how well it's working.
I guess what I would say is that the permit conditions have been running for lots of years and not been very effective. So it's 2 years going, if either they're going to work or they're not going to work, the neighbors, everybody's living with these conditions. Hey, either you're going to make these conditions work or you're not. It's going to happen right away or it's not. If it's important, it'll happen. If it's not important, it won't happen. That would just be my, just because of the duration of, as this conversation has gone on for so long.
So is that kind of a baby step? Do we do that, 3 fields in 1 year?
Well, I don't like the idea of increasing the traffic.
Of increasing?
Or decreasing it from 4 to 3.
Yeah, why would that be increased?
From the original motion.
Right.
Yeah. The original motion.
2 fields, 2 years, two and two.
And so as far as if they're not complying, then there's things in place.
That's a good point. Yeah, it's not like we don't have any.
They're just carte blanche.
Citizenry.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
So then
I would remove my suggestion and I would second the original.
So 2 year expiration, 2 fields.
Too much discussion.
Yeah. That was the third.
Yeah, I was trying to think of something. All right, so we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Opposed? There we go. Thank you, everybody. I know this has been a tough run. It's been pleasant for anyone.
7 years since they got the original permit, and they haven't adhered to it at all. So I liked his idea of a year. I would have been much more receptive to that, because if anything would have happened, they would have had, the spring and the fall season, or the fall coming up in the spring. But 7 years, I'm just, in Northampton overall, I'm just reading things in the public about everything. It seems like you can do so much here and not have any repercussions, and it's frustrating. But I appreciate your time, and thank you for the 2 year limit.
Thank you. We still have some minutes, yes, just minutes. I'm sure everybody read them, so I will read you the dates, unless we want to do these individually. We have, I need a motion to approve.
We're good.
Carolyn's got them.
Oh, February 27th, March 27th, May 8th, May 12th. May 22nd, June 19th, June 12th, June 9th, June 12th, and June 26th.
So I need a motion to approve or amend or edit.
I make a motion to approve the minutes from dates that Carolyn.
Second, that's all in favor. There we go. Anything else, Carolyn?
No.
Yeah.
Nice job.
Meeting adjourned.
Yeah.